You didn't?
They weren't born.
In Southern California.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Some of them weren't born yet. I realize that. Okay, what happened in 1971? Sylmar earthquake. So the Sylmar earthquake would just be up the 210 a little ways. And there wasn't the 210 freeway then. And there wasn't mass communication. You know, everybody with a cell phone. So a lot of the communication about what happened wasn't readily known. It took a while. So you lived how many miles, dude? 5 miles from the epicenter of the quake.
Yeah.
So in the beginning of this book, it's Self-Sufficient Home, so I'm talking about all these things we're going to discuss today. But dude was in the Marines. He was into gardening, so he was already into camping. So a person who has camping gear, you know, you have scout gear. Yeah. You're used to camping outdoors. You're used to using portable toilets. You're used to making your own food, finding things in the wild, maybe hunting. So you're already a step above the average person who gets everything from the supermarket and whose mindset is just getting everything from the supermarket. So, I mean, that helps. Or if you grew up on a farm, you know that you don't depend on everybody for every little thing. So it was 1971. He and his wife were both 33. You were once 33?
Yeah. Hard to believe.
It is hard to believe. And his children were 2, 9, and 12 when the 7.1 Sylmar earthquake hit. We were only 5 miles as the crow flies from the epicenter of the quake. You all know where Sylmar is, right?
Yeah.
From here up to 210, and you can be there in 5 minutes. So I was living in Pasadena with my parents, and I was living on the second floor of the house, and that was pretty scary, thinking the whole place was going to collapse in Pasadena. It was early in the morning, about 5 a.m. The noise of the quake was deafening. I can't even describe it. It was like being next to a train going by, and you can't hear your conversation, but multiply that by 1,000. McLean recalls, the earth was grinding and moving, and it was like a giant shockwave hit the house. It was like some giant had wrapped his hands around the house and shook it every which way. It was very much like being hit with a bomb. In fact, my first words when the quake began was, they got us, thinking that the Russians hit us, right? Because you still had all the missiles and all the Cold War stuff. But he then realized it was an earthquake. There was crashing in his house as things were falling everywhere, and he ran into the bedroom of his two youngest children. While the house was still shaking, he held one under each arm and carried them out of the house into a big field across the street. The house had four doors as exits, but I could only get one open, you know, because the others get jammed because the walls are shifting. So I took the two youngest to the field, set them down, and told them to stay. Then I ran back into the house, naked and barefoot, oh my God, and got my older daughter out of the house. McLean took her to the field across the street with the other children, and they went back into the house. My wife was turning in circles in the house. She was shocked, right?
Yeah.
So you often hear about some people who don't know what to do, and actually, you know, your whole life is falling apart, and everything is breaking that you value, and so people panic. So in the first moments of an earthquake, that's what you don't want to be. You don't want to just be panicked and not know what to do, or do the most terrible thing, you know, do the wrong thing. Fortunately, dude was there. I mean, really.
The living room was a 600-square-foot living room, and it was taking things up on the shelves and throwing them into the middle of the room. That's a long way. So she was just standing going, because everything was coming down.
He says he doesn't know how he escaped without getting his feet cut, because there's glass everywhere.
Yeah, I have no clue.
McLean explains that when it got light, neighbors checked on other neighbors, and there were no major injuries or death. The water line that provided water to the approximately 200 homes in the canyon, this was Cago Canyon, was broken every 6 to 20 feet, meaning no water. You're not going to turn on your spigot and have a bath this morning, or make your coffee. If you didn't have water stored, you had no water. How long before any city or anybody brought water into that area?
About 4 days.
4 days. 4 days. So that's a good question. I mean, a lot of these things we'll touch on again, but how much water do you use in 4 days? Your whole family. Then you have children, you have pets, you have plants maybe. You might be surprised how much water you use. Dude and I watched a survival video, and I won't say who it was, but it had a guy talking about home storage of water, you know, all the emergency stuff, and he had 5 gallons of water. That's nothing. Cora, you'd use that up just, you know, drinking coffee in the morning, right? I mean, really, 5 gallons is nothing. Seriously. So, I mean, it's something that you have, that. But I got 40 gallons in the last rain without trying. And that can go quick. So generally you want a couple hundred gallons per household. That would be good for the few days, if you, depending on the size of the household, and if you ration even. Telephone, electricity, and gas lines were out. Okay, so there wasn't cell phones back then. And actually, I think cell phones would go out too.
Yeah.
Because most of our cell phones are land-based. So you might want to, I'm not really going to get into that today, but you might also want to think about alternate communication systems.
Some of the telephone systems are operational, all trucks are going to be busy.
They'll jam up.
Right.
Yeah.
It'll be jammed up. Nobody will get to anything.
That's why I always say, get to know your neighbors. About 30, the main access road to the canyon had shifted about 2 feet, so a truck was needed to get in or out. So you really couldn't drive. You can't ever predict what's going to happen. One of the things you can predict, though, is that the unpredictable is what's usually going to happen. Right? The thing that everybody is waiting for is not the thing that happens. The things that you all, that's why it's an emergency. You didn't predict it. You couldn't expect it. About 30% of the homes in the canyon were totally destroyed. Some people packed up and never came back. About a dozen houses were shaken down to rubble piles about 4 feet high. Can you imagine that? That's your whole home, right? All your stuff. Homes were down in the creek. So so basically I talk about what they did, but they had a few weeks of food and water. They had, I don't want to read it all, but you had containers of water.
Yeah.
He had fuel for cooking. He had stoves to cook on. He had food to cook. He had fruit trees and a garden in the yard. He had first aid supplies. What did you have for a toilet? Mm-hmm. You had some kind of a toilet, a porta potty or something?
Yeah, a porta potty to start with.
Because you're not going to be flushing your toilet if it's not going anywhere.
Yeah, well, I had a septic system.
Okay.
But there was no water.
Okay.
So,
but you could still
waste water, using it to flush.
Right, right.
What kind of a porta potty was it?
It was just a little camping porta potty
with a plastic bag type thing.
Yeah.
In fact, I would say that in an emergency, probably if you want to boil it down, your biggest concerns is your food, and eating supplies is one big thing, because if you go to Trader Joe's or Vons every day to get meals, a lot of people do, they're not going to be there. If they're not collapsed, they're going to be looted next, right? Think about it. So if you don't have food, that's going to be one problem. If you need medical supplies, you should always have more than what you think you need, because you're not going to be able to get your medical supplies if you need that. If you have some specific medical condition. And then hygiene in a toilet is another big area. So most people don't like to think about it, but when you go out on camping trips and there's no outhouses, you have to deal with that. So those are some of your big concerns. Yes, you have a comment?
The thing that we did, there were so many people there that couldn't cook. I had people bring everything.
What do you mean couldn't? They had no way to do it.
So we brought stuff to my place. I had a large driveway. And so we started cooking everybody's food. Your food's going to last longer if it's cooked. So we started cooking a lot of food. And I had 2 55-gallon drums of water and then a couple of 30-gallon drums of water, plus other little things of water. And they were all outside. And the scary part, I think people don't realize the shock you go through with something like that. And that earthquake, by the way, not only went through Pasadena, it went down through Burbank and into Hollywood. Chimneys went down. All kind of affected a large area.
Was that the San Andreas, they say?
McClamo Fault or something. And the town of San Fernando, the whole houses went down. It was like wiped out, too.
Mm-hmm.
So you had a problem. But it goes right back to you can't rely on anybody else. The government just didn't have it, city government, county government, whatever it is, they didn't have it together enough. They finally put some places in San Fernando for the people around those areas, but I was actually 10 miles from San Fernando. So
that's a long distance under those circumstances.
Yeah, and I had a four-wheel drive truck, so I could get out. A lot of people couldn't get out. Took houses, like it said in there, it threw them right off of their foundations into the creek. They slid right down. They were gone. But having your food and having your water enough, and like Christopher said, just to push that point, you've got to have a lot of water. You really have. Even if you're storing it in small containers, you can scatter them all over the place, and don't put your water all in one spot.
Right, because maybe you can't get to that spot. In fact, For least earthquakes or even other kind of emergencies too, the water is probably the single most important thing, certainly here, that you need to prepare for. It's also the easiest and the quickest and the cheapest thing you can do. It isn't all that costly. So let me see a show of hands, how many of you store water? Okay, well that's good, a little bit, that's good, better than none.
I want to make one
quick point before you move on. And anybody with pertinent points is free to speak up.
Yeah. You know. I don't think you realize the trauma / shock, even if it's a little bit, you go through. Because if you have something to focus on, you already have a mindset, I've got this and this and this, you immediately go to work to do it. Some people ran. They were like scared dogs. And I don't blame them. It was very scary. But the thing that got you was for the next 10 or 12 days. When you sat down on the ground, it was like jelly. It
you
never stopped shaking.
It was very irritating.
Everybody stopped.
You always felt nervous.
For a year after that, my house, thank God, was okay structurally. But every place where there was a little tiny fissure that big, if a structure was in front of that little fissure, your house went down. That's all it took. It wasn't very much. But for a year after that, my whole family, we all slept in the living room. The kids would not sleep in their bedrooms. That was it. And my son, you know, he's a little kid. He was 2 years old, 2.5 years old. And he just kept looking at the walls going fall. Because he remembered everything coming down.
Oh, that's funny.
But just that tremor, just all the time like that, was very unnerving.
San Andreas, you also, is over there.
Oh, it's okay.
It's basically ready.
Yeah, and you're right near next to it.
You're right on it, practically, aren't you? So,
yeah, but he's on the other side.
Oh, so that's okay.
So that's okay, because this is the side that's going to fall in the ocean.
we're actually technically, you know, in the Native Americans speak of Turtle Island, Turtle Island being North America, we're not on Turtle Island. We're not on the North American plate. Yeah. We're west of the fault. We're part of the Pacific plate.
Yeah. Well, I have my own theory. I believe that the other side, east, from the San Andreas Fault is going to fall in the ocean.
That's because Gary lives out there.
Yeah, we're going to be the island.
Actually, it's a slip.
Well, if I had to be 20 miles from the San Andreas Fault, I would much rather be 20 miles south of the San Andreas Fault than north of the San Andreas Fault.
But the San Andreas Fault is a north-south fault.
No, it goes west-northwest and east-southeast north of the sphere.
Yeah.
But that means preferred locking down it to Lancaster.
There's some spots where it's hung up south of L.A., where it hasn't moved. And up north, too.
Is that like Montebello, or where? Where would that spot
they
be?
They say they're going to really move them.
You never know. Okay, that's the point, is we don't really know. And Dude has a good point, though, too. It's one thing. We're going to be talking about stuff. But unless you've like gone out on survival expeditions or been in the military, there's really no telling even what you're going to do. You think you know yourself, you really discover yourself, and people who've been through these in books and in stories, they talk about the worst of human nature comes out and the best of human nature comes out. Interestingly, just the book that came to mind, if you've ever read it, is Screwtape Letters. Ever read Screwtape Letters by C.S. Lewis? This is an illiterate group.
Have you
never read it, have you?
Okay. I've never read it. So
it's a good book.
I believe you. I can't stand being illiterate.
I know. Okay, no, please stay. I beg of you. Okay, who said they store water again? Okay, Jim, how do you store your water? What kind of a containers?
I was just wondering how many people here live in apartments or condos like I do.
Okay, that's a big difference, apartment versus a home. You live in an apartment.
Yeah.
So how do you store water?
Those gallon containers.
Okay, and gallon...
Which kind of gallon containers?
They're plastic.
That's what I was going to ask them.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, like you know, like Arrowhead and Cascade, things like that.
They're real thin plastic.
Yeah, and I noticed over time, they're just going to degrade.
Sometimes in six months.
Pardon me?
Sometimes in six months. If you buy the thick plastic ones, they'll last. I have some of those that I had for 10 years.
They're like they're bigger 3 to 5 gallons. Though,
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
But I do have a
good one.
Okay. Let's focus on one thing at a time. First, the plastics. The cheap plastics like Sparklets, the 1 gallon ones, they're almost not worth getting. And Dude did an experiment with containers, because just to back up a bit, you can store in just about anything. That's why I'm asking what you store in. You could store in used containers and you have soft drinks. Rinse it out, or you buy bottled water, rinse it out, fill it with water. Some are better than others. Glass, of course, is inert. You buy fruit juice, rinse it out, fill it with tap water. Tap water already has the chlorine in it. You don't need to do anything. Okay, so any kind of a container. Dude did do an experiment with bottled, with plastic for regular water versus carbonated water. You have a far higher grade of plastic in the carbonated because it's under pressure when it shakes accidentally. So those plastics are definitely worth keeping for long-term water storage. You could store in just about anything. Glass is fine. Plastic is fine. The food-grade blue drums are good.
During an earthquake, the glass could break.
The glass could break. So I have boxes like milk crates, these and wooden things, and I pack plastic, glass, and put paper between them. So it's going to shake around maybe under the house, but hopefully the glass won't break. The glass is better because it's inert, so you can mix them up to give yourself a buffer. I also get these food-grade drums, which are plastic, and I try to get them cheap, and I try to get them used and free, if possible, from the food industry. And your guess is as good as mine where to get them. I mean, you could go buy them. Major Surplus sells the drums for like $70 new, so I watch their sales when they're half price. These are big blue food-grade drums.
How many gallons?
30, I think they're 40 gallons.
Oh, yeah.
I have a couple of those,
yeah.
But from the food industry, you can get discarded pickle jars and things that are 30 or so gallons. I usually pay $20 and sometimes more, sometimes less.
Those are glass.
Chew on your food grade is also good because it doesn't leach PVAs.
Okay, and where did the bucket come from that you had? Oh, you saw an ad on Craigslist, right? So you can always get used containers, but I encourage you to always do it little by little by little. You cannot have enough water, I guarantee you.
Yeah. The other thing you got to do when you get a bigger container, you don't know where you're going to be when this happens. So the 40 gallons of water times 8. A gallon of water weighs about 8 pounds.
It's heavy.
It gets pretty heavy.
You're not gonna
so what you want to get is a little portable pump to pump that stuff out.
Yes.
And I would get a couple of those because it could fail on you. But they're pretty inexpensive. And you can get those locally at Major Surplus too.
Yeah, they're you can get them at hardware stores
also,
as well.
Also, just the hose with the pump too is good to have.
Yeah.
To siphon the water.
Yeah.
So you want as many containers as possible. Tap water is fine. And how long does water store? Does anybody know the answer to that? Does what like water goes bad? Maybe is the point behind that question. Water per se doesn't really go bad at all.
He said 10 years.
No, I've had it.
Oh, you had it for 10 years.
No,
oh,
the problem. Okay. What will happen to water is that it's not moving. It's not being oxygenated. You will get some green algae.
Oh.
Assuming there was clean water when you stored it, there's not going to be bugs that are in there later. Okay.
But even the ones that were at the algae, I got no algae in them that were stored in the dark.
Stored in the dark.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I used to store water at my parents' house, and people do say 6 months you should rotate. As a realistic matter, people rotate maybe every 5 years or more, because who goes and empties all the water?
But you just refilter it into a different container?
No, I just dump it into the garden and refill it, put it back.
Yeah, at least use it.
In other words, I know it's nice to read the proper way to do it, you know, and it might take all day, but most people have busy lives. If it's going to take you a long time to do it, you're not going to do it. So I take the bucket, dump it on a fruit tree, refill it with the hose. In 2 minutes, I've refilled that every 5 years when I think about it.
Every 5 years when you think about it?
If I think about it that often, you know. But I have done it recently. I've dumped some of the buckets under trees and just refilled them with the hose, and I'm done in a few minutes. Yeah.
So you don't use reverse osmosis water in your storage? You just put tap water?
I usually don't.
Because the chlorine keeps it...
That's right.
Chlorine and the chlorine deteriorates anyway.
Oh, it does.
Yeah.
But that's only if the cap's open, though, right?
It does break down.
It'll break down if it's got a closed lid.
It'll still break down.
Okay. Chemically, it'll still break down. Now, its function is not water purification in water storage. Its function is to retard the growth of algae.
Oh.
That's its primary function. The water should already be pure. It's a bit of a misnomer that all of these bottled waters that everybody's drinking, including you, Mr. McLean.
This came out of my big Berkey.
Okay, so let's see, I drew a false conclusion there. I wasn't trying to say you're a bad person.
But, yes, you were.
Maybe I was thinking it. But it's a false notion that the tap water is inherently worse than these bottled waters. And sometimes the bottled water is just tap water.
Yeah.
Sparklet's water, pardon me?
You have a filter, too. It's good to have.
Yeah, you should get a filter. I have... These you can get, and just these are just things you can get in any supermarket, and it's a little carbon filter, and you could do this at home to filter out whatever's in the water. Yeah.
You can also get those little tiny water purifiers that I forget how many gallons it works for, but they're really tiny and portable.
Pills?
No, but they're like these things that you...
Screw on your faucet?
The kind it's not even a screw on a faucet. It's for an emergency situation.
Okay. So you go see that white pump filter right there? That's to take out biological contaminants in your water. That's a Timberline water filter. Okay, any backpacking store sells these. The thing is, you would only be concerned about that if you were relying on other sources than what you stored after an earthquake. Other sources that could be polluted and contaminated. There could be swimming pools, and you don't know how many people urinated in there, or dead animals are in there, or what. So you do want to run it through a filter or boil it, because boiling will kill biological contaminants. Yes.
In the previous house, I had four of the 5 gallon water, big sparkling water bottles, brand new, and they were sitting in the garage near a window, and the ultraviolet light actually deteriorated the cap. They'd been sitting there for a couple years, and went back to 3 out of the 4. The cap was already just cracked and. Water was
gone. The sun got them.
And the water evaporated out?
No, the water wasn't. No. But the fact is, I don't know who knows how long that cap had been open and what got in there and whatever. But the sun got the cap and.
Yeah, so having containers in the dark is better. This is true. At my parents' house, I used to get these 5 gallon bakery buckets, usually for free, because bakeries get frosting and cherries and dough and whatever in these buckets, and they just toss them, like Jergensen used to toss them all. And now I think you pay a quarter or 50 cents, but usually you can get a good bucket with a seal. And I filled all those with water. I probably did it in around 1970, 75 maybe. Had about 30 or 40 of those in their basement and 30 or 40 out in the backyard patio, which got sun sometime. And after they died, it was probably 2003 or 4, the house got sold. I took all the ones out of the basement.
What?
You know, they just wanted them, people wanted them removed. And there was a little bit of algae. I just want to see what it's like, you know. It had a little bit of green strands in some of the buckets. But I guarantee you, if there's an emergency and you have no water, you could deal with that, those green strands. Green algae is actually edible. And it's a protein, basically. If it bothers you, you boil it and you just strain the water. Now, the ones outside, I remember kicking one of the buckets with my foot and it shattered. And I started moving those, and the pieces would break off. So the water was probably okay, but the plastic was just totally brittle. Nobody had touched them or moved them in all those years. But it just fell apart. So that's not the place to store them. In the garage would have been better. Okay, so water, store as much as you possibly can in any possible container. And purification systems, it's good to have something in your home, but the universal method is to boil your water. Now, any questions up to that point?
How long do you boil the water for?
Okay, who knows the answer? Jorge knows the answer to that. How long do you boil your water if you think it's impure?
Until it actually starts bubbling, until it actually reaches a boil.
And that's it?
Yeah.
Everything is killed that gets you sick at about 170 degrees. Water boils at what temperature?
212,
right? Something like that, whatever. So it's already, by the time it's boiling, you've killed everything that gets you sick.
You want to boil a little bit longer, at higher elevation, because it boils quicker. So you want to boil a little bit.
Even if it boils quicker, isn't it the...
That's fine. It still kills,
but it still
boils at lower
temperature. Oh, it does boil cooler. Oh, actually, interesting.
Because it boils at lower temperature, higher.
Yeah, but it still only has to reach 170.
Now,
there's a thing that I have, you may have seen it advertised. If you Google it, called Big Berkey. And Big Berkey is a water purifier and filter, which is a big difference. A lot of things are a filter only. Doesn't mean it's purified.
It's the stainless steel
thing?
It's
a stainless steel. It sits about this high. You can get them a different size.
It looks like a commercial coffee thing, right?
Yeah, almost. Right. And it's about this big, and you fill the top, and it's got these cones that come up, and everything purifies and filters through that, and it drops down into the bottom. Mine holds 2 gallons.
And this came from your Big Berkey?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And so I even take my tap water and put it through there.
B-U-R-K-Y?
Yeah, Big Berkey. They're made in England, I believe, but these are used all over the world by the Red Cross, World Health Organization, et cetera, et cetera, in some really bad places. If you're going to, it's really more for a long-term situation.
And it's really for home, not for the
it's
trail.
Really for, you don't take it with you, because these kind of filters and stuff, they're fine, but eventually they're all going to clog up on you.
if you get nasty water. And I bought mine with extra filters and all that kind of stuff.
Was it charcoal?
Pardon?
Charcoal filters?
Is it a charcoal
filter?
They're
a combination of charcoal and some kind of a ceramic. It tells you. If you Google it, you'll find it. It'll give you everything.
How often do you change them, roughly?
Oh, I've used the same ones for. You can tell by looking at it, and you clean them. You know, all you do is scrape the outside a little bit, and I've done that maybe 10 times, and I've had this thing since 1996, I think.
I think I've seen ads for it in Countryside Magazine.
Yeah, that's
They run about $300, right?
Yeah, they're up there. Mine ran when I bought it, I think they were $179 or something.
Who makes it?
Berkey.
That's the name of the company.
It's the name of it. Big Berkey.
Katadyn has one similar where it's... You 15,000 gallons.
Yeah, this is 25,000.
And Katadyn is probably the Cadillac of water purifiers. It's probably a lot pricier than Dude's, right?
No, it's about $250.
$250,
yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah, I think that's what Big Berkey's is.
So you have a lot of options out there. So we're not recommending one product over the other. You might go to a yard sale. You know, I've got some of the best products at divorce sales and yard sales and moving sales and estate sales. People are just unloading it all.
Yeah.
And, so it's a Katadyn or this or that, but you want some way to purify the water, whatever you choose.
You said something about charcoal. If you didn't have one of these things that you bought ahead of time, would you take some wood, burn it, and use the charcoal to do that?
Okay, yeah, you could. Keep in mind that boiling will kill biological contaminants. But campers have tossed the black char into the water because it does absorb toxins. Then you have to strain that out. I'm not sure why you would do that unless you couldn't make a fire though. Because the boiling does the same thing.
Okay,
so the commercial filters all use charcoal or what do they call it? They treat the charcoal so it doesn't grow something. Activated charcoal.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. You knew all about storing water, but you didn't. Right? The earthquake when you go home tonight when I'm having dinner. And it'll be very disruptive to my dinner plans. And so what are the sources of water that you could now use? What could you use now? You didn't store anything. You didn't do any of the things that we talked about. But so now what?
Hot water heater.
Hot water heater. Good point. Have you ever drained your hot water heater to get water?
No, it'd probably be scary.
Who's done that? Anybody? Okay.
I've drained it for maintenance, and there's a lot of sand and stuff in there.
Yes,
okay.
Yeah.
How did you drain it for maintenance? You opened the little thing, right?
Yeah, there's a spigot at the bottom.
Okay,
and
I encourage you all to look at that little
it
spigot.
It melted my hose.
What?
Because it was so hot?
It melted my hose.
Valve at top, the
cheap
pressure valve. You might relieve the pressure before you
That's right.
There.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you'll find that in some cases, you won't even...
Open
I would say, and if you've never done it, how often do you drain your water heater? You take a little bit of water out of
once
the bottom.
Once a year.
Okay, I would say once a month if you really want to maintain the life of the heater. Pardon me?
I paid so much for it, I want it to last.
Because a water heater can die out in 10 to 12 years or 20 or more years. It's largely because all of the corrosion on the bottom from the... You know when you have a coffee pot and eventually there's this layer of stuff in the inside? That's the minerals in the water. Okay, that builds up on the water heater. If you never drain it, it builds up, and that flame is working more and more to heat through all of that crud to heat the water. So if you drain it out, the water heater works better. Now, sometimes rust will come out, little sediment will come out, but if you wait till an earthquake and it's been 8 years since you've had the heater, you're going to do that and nothing will come out. You can put a little wire up there and maybe loosen it all up and you might get some water. So you have 30 or so gallons potentially there, if you can get to it. What else?
Toilet.
The toilet tank, of course. Toilet tank, yeah. As long as you don't have the blue things, of course. What else?
Pool.
Swimming pool. Now, is that a good source of water?
Yeah.
Pretty good.
Is it?
You got to boil out the chlorine.
Yeah, just boil it. Of course it's a good source of water. I always tell people to watch Hotel Rwanda. You know, people will do all kind of things in an emergency, but it's more chlorine than you get in your drinking water, but of course it's a good source of water for food, washing, whatever. What's another source of water?
Jacuzzi. We're upscaling.
Okay, so Jim doesn't have a pool, but you have a pool.
No, I don't have one.
Right?
I used to years ago.
Okay, so maybe.
Does that count?
Well, of course it counts. It's water. You'd be surprised
even
what people
though it was
use
yours?
In an emergency. Yeah. These people in Libya and Egypt, that are in all every time you have refugees from the Civil War, they scramble. They'll take whatever they can get. Trash. You won't you won't be a Sierra Club guy and turn up your nose at all the trash. You'll pick everything up because you know you can use it tonight for something.
Right.
And you're going to see multiple uses of things. You know all the... There's a company that tries to promote not using the bottled water. And they say it because of all the plastic waste. But in Africa, you take these quart bottles, people make sandals out of them. They crush them and they put...
Patagonia makes their leather jackets out of
plastic bottles. Yeah, you can actually make it, and we don't even think about it because we're so wealthy. But our trash, really, it can be useful, especially in an emergency. So what are some other water sources?
Freezer, your ice box.
Okay, what you have in your freezer, because that's going to melt anyway, but there it is, and if you have ice cubes, I don't actually make ice cubes, so I wouldn't have anything in my freezer. What else?
Urine.
Fish pond.
Okay, that might be the bottom of the barrel. But that's a possibility.
Was that selective listening? I said urine.
I that clearly was selective listening because I pretty much tuned that out.
It's water.
On Discovery.
Okay, no. That, okay, urine could be used to wash wounds. Okay, I wouldn't use it for water, for drinking. I know some people say that it's okay and they use it for medical reasons, but it is a waste product, and I think there are reasons why you really wouldn't want to drink it, right? I mean,
You can't do it very long.
If you make a solar still, you could pee around the solar still and the soil around it.
So,
but that's about it.
So we're not getting into wilderness things, but I have pictures of solar stills in this book if you don't know how to do it. We'll do that another time. Okay, so that's very marginal.
Distilling it'd be all right.
What?
Distilling it,
like in the Flight of the Phoenix. What are some other water sources that are just kind of out there or in your home?
Stream, upstream.
Okay, maybe you live near a stream. Believe it or not, there are springs, even in Pasadena. There's one that, you know, when we go down by the golf course, we walk by that little path with all that water. Yeah. That's a natural spring there.
Yeah.
So those people in that neighborhood could actually get that. And they're all over. So you do have springs. If you live up in the mountains, you could go down. And I'm sure there's going to be a lot of people who want that water if all the arteries of water are broken. And by the way, I think maybe you all know this, but here in Southern California, do we get all of our water somewhere else or just some of it?
Most of it
comes from somewhere else. We get maximum maybe 25% from underground. Like right here, this aquifer is where we, Pasadena, probably you don't in Montebello.
Yeah, we have aquifers there.
No, I said probably you don't use
no,
this
we don't
water
use this one, no.
In Montebello, but you probably do have yours there.
Oh, right.
Most
near
of
my
our
house,
water comes from the Central Valley of California or the Colorado River.
Yep.
So in an earthquake, a lot of that might be severed and it'll just seep into the ground.
If you've done some hiking, take a look at the springs that you go by also. You know, and remember where some of these springs are.
Well, right. What happens sometimes in an earthquake, and it happened in the Sylmar earthquake, there used to be a natural spring in San Fernando in a park, and the minute that earthquake hit, it shut down.
Yeah.
And so they can change too. And there was a creek that ran behind my house.
We have the aqua.
The creek went, it disappeared. It went underground and came up right up by my house and it was maybe a block long. And that was the only part that surfaced, way up above and way down below.
Yeah, because things are changing and they're gone. I want you to think of some other water sources.
Water reservoirs.
What about that? If you have a means to distill, you can do that. Now, people who have been stranded do sip ocean water, but I wouldn't encourage you to try to do that. If you could dilute ocean water 50% with fresh water, you could extend your supplies. People have done that. But if you have a way to distill it, of course you can do that. There are solar distillers. Okay, here's a picture. This may not apply to all of you, but if you, and again, some of these things, if you hadn't planned ahead, it's going to mean absolutely nothing to you. But if you have a device, this is a, I've seen a big plexiglass thing. This was 4x8 and had a divider. And they put the ocean water here, set this out in the sun. And so it would distill up and drip down into this section.
Mm.
Yeah, but it was time consuming. It was as big as this table, so it was somewhat practical to get your water that way. So ocean water is practical.
We didn't talk about runoff from the house or apartment building,
rain,
did we?
Rain. Can we use rainwater?
Yeah.
Huh? One of the ways I get my rainwater, first off, my roof is painted with this Henry's white product that I know Dude is really fond of the Obama administration, and that's good. But when one of the staff early on said that you should paint your roofs white and it would help help the energy crisis, whatever, it was actually sound advice. and it was he was laughed out of the media. But I did that like 20 years ago because I couldn't afford a new roof at the time. So we used a Henry, actually it was a Henry's product or another one, and it's liquid rubber basically. And it seals little cracks in your roof, and it made the house temperature in the summer 15 degrees cooler. Okay, so it really did make a difference. And why am I talking about that?
The white rock.
The rain one. Okay.
Okay.
So because the whole because the roof is rubber now, when it rains, it all the sand cleans up real quickly. Because a normal 3-ply asphalt shingle roof, when you collect the rainwater, you're getting all that sand and grit, and you have to do a little more purification. So my roof will clean off real quickly. I always wait about a half an hour. All the bird poop and dirt and everything is washed off, and then I collect it in drums or 5-gallon buckets or whatever. When the roof is all clean, I actually have a big funnel. I put it in a sparklets bottle, and I put a cloth like a pillowcase, because that's a fine cotton weave, and I use that water for coffee and soup and stuff.
If you set up a water catchment system on the average garage, it's about 20 by 20. If it rains an inch an hour, you're going to collect over 600 gallons of water.
Yeah, the problem is always how to store it.
You have to have the storage facility.
But rain is a very viable source of water. After the Northridge quake 2 days later, there was rain, and people were collecting rain. Yes.
Question. What is the name, like that guy over there? He's living in an apartment. I'm living in
What guy?
In an
this
apartment.
Guy?
Who, me?
Corey.
Oh, this guy, Corey, right here.
Oh, Corey. You know, how do we do it like that?
I have no idea.
I have a...
But I have to figure it out.
You might work something out.
You know, a gutter that comes down, okay. And that's where I collected mine from, inside of the apartment.
Oh, do we have a gutter?
A lot of...
When it rains, look at where your water pattern is.
Yeah, where it's draining to.
And obviously, don't think of all of this in a vacuum. Back when I was in Highland Park, I was always the one that ran neighborhood watch, just because when there were things that went wrong, people kind of waited around for the police and the fire. So what are we waiting for, you know? So we organized, and people finally started doing things for themselves in the neighborhood. It still isn't much better, you know. But part of this is working with whoever you have in your neighborhood or your apartment building, and maybe there's a way they can do it for everybody. Nobody's an island after all, right? Everything's going to go a lot further if rather than pretending that it's all my water and I'm all cool now and forgetting about everybody else. It's better if you think about more people. It does work better, believe it or not. Dude has taught me that. To go from my greed, small little tiny picture of the world,
right.
to see more people, you know, more people, more work. More people can do more things.
He had led a cloistered life.
Very cloistered, yeah. He helped me to see the light. Okay, so there are a lot of water sources, but you have to... Okay, reservoirs.
They'll be guarded.
You think they will?
Yeah.
Maybe not.
I bet you.
But all it takes to get into a reservoir is a crescent wrench in most cases. And they might be guarded. But you have to think the severity of the quake versus are these guys' top priority going to be their family?
Yeah,
or are they going to go there and guard a reservoir?
I think a lot of cops and a lot of firemen won't show up for work.
Did they show up during Katrina? No.
Yeah, they showed up in Rockford.
There you go.
Yeah,
there you go.
They took the guns, I think.
What about reclaiming water from, like, pipes that have broken that have water just running out of them? You have to do that immediately.
But you have to get to them. They can be down 6 feet.
All right.
Okay, now, if you have a house that's multiple storied,
right.
you could open a valve in the lower part and drain the pipes. Maybe you get 5 or 10 gallons. No, probably not 10. You know, maybe a couple of gallons that way. So really, there are many, many sources of water to think about. When you go around in your neighborhood, you should see what's in your neighborhood. Are there fountains? Are there ornamental things? So-and-so has a pool. You should take mental stock of that. But don't just think, well, Corey's thinking, well, I can just go into the neighbor's pool when there's an earthquake. Maybe you can, maybe you can't.
And maybe you always want to provide for your own family. Drained out anyway.
Could be.
We've got the California aqueduct right by.
And that's going to go, too. That'll be fun.
And that's going to crack. Typically, it's going to be cracking. And it's going to drain in certain areas, but they got caps in certain areas, so, you know, but to consider that as a source, there's a big source of water right there.
You guys looking at birds today?
No, we were doing the walkabout.
Oh, I heard about that.
I have to go to Australia.
What are you guys doing?
We're doing a walkabout. We're just it's a stand. It's a it's like a more
standabout.
More
standabout.
Sedentary walkabout.
We're lazy.
Talk about.
We're the lazy walkabout.
We're talking about a walkabout.
Short distance walkabout.
We're doing a sitabout.
Have a good time. No, they advertised tours on this park today, where they're showing people what Hahamangna's like.
Nice. Who is?
And it was going to be a few weeks ago, and it rained, and so they figured nobody's going to want to come out in the rain, so they were scheduling it for today.
Who's sponsoring?
I don't know. Oh. Who's sponsoring it? This walkabout thing.
Gee, it's
City of Pasadena.
The city?
No, it's not the City of Pasadena. It's actually the
Sierra Club.
There's a little fiber in the cactus itself is going to absorb a lot of that fluid.
Thank you. Yeah, I got an email about it, but. Thank you.
So what about your car? You'd want to put some water in your car, huh, in case you're on the road when something happens.
Okay, that's kind of a whole other area. Yeah. But you should have a minimal survival kit in your car. Some water, a little bit of food, maybe a space blanket or a fold-up blanket, first aid kit, a change of clothes. I've had stuff in my car only because where I live, when it rains or when there's a fire, I can't get in or out. I'm in or I'm out. I'm living out of my car. And thankfully, I've had places I could go to and not didn't have to go to the park with Roadkill Bill and live under the outhouse.
A lot of people have a bug out bag.
We're going to get to that. Frank brought a little bag and he's going to demonstrate it, but I want to cover some of this first. Okay, any other questions on water?
Well, we used to be able to use our radiator, but these days with all those chemicals.
Nobody uses water in the radiator.
Just a reminder.
The old days, Jim is reminding us. Cool. Dude and Jim are both approaching 80.
Well, so are you.
Well, this is true. I'm a fast.
We're all approaching 80.
He's teetering on the age of teasers.
There was a time where you could drain your radiator and it was just water
under,
or rusty water, and you could strain that and use it for drinking if you had to in the desert. But that's a good point. You should have stuff in your car too, because how often are you at home? And you more often, most people are away from home.
Yeah.
So you don't know where you might be when something bad happens. And it may not be an earthquake. It could be something else. Terrorist thing. Some kind of gas. Who knows? Could be any
fire,
whatever.
Yeah. Fire in these mountains will shut you down.
Yep.
All kinds of areas just getting out of here.
We just had fire a couple years ago.
Yeah. And I was stuck
in
the
said we've
side.
Already had fire.
We've already had fire. It's not going to happen. Yeah. Okay, cool. We're done with fire. All miracles will now cease.
Okay.
As a last resort, we can dig for water.
True. You can dig for water in most areas. You can
add a shovel.
You can just dig a well. Some
use
areas
what you got,
you'll find it and some you won't. Areas where water had flowed or settled is where you're most likely to find it.
So that is a
viable option, but
dry
it definitely
stream.
Depends on the area. Okay, food supplies. I remember in the 70s, there were a lot of these companies that came because in the early 70s, we were told by the various prophets of doom at that time that there would be a famine for sure by 1978 or 79. There was even a book called The Crash of 78. There'd be an oil embargo and, we would all be reduced to savages or something like that. That didn't happen.
Great state of California.
Something like that, yeah. One of the reasons why that didn't happen is because in the free enterprise system, greed is the oil that runs the machinery that gets us stuff. And I'm using greed in the sense of the dude's favorite movie. What was that guy? Greed is good. What was that movie?
Gecko?
Yeah, Gecko's thing. No, but really, if you think about it, if you're very naive, you think, well, there's a disaster and nothing happens. But everybody's job, it's in their self-interest to do a lot of these things. So food still moves. But when
survival for something and being prepared is, well, you just mentioned the word job. If you lose your job, you can be in trouble. That's your survival mode.
Yeah, exactly. It's not just an earthquake, of course, especially now. So,
I read about a family that the husband, they gave him a month notice before they're going to lay him off. And all they did was they would go and get canned foods. They would just, whatever money they had, because they knew they had the budget.
Right.
I thought that was pretty smart.
That is smart.
He at least had a month's notice.
Because one of the things you can always predict, Gary taught me this, okay, I always remember where I learned these things, is that there's a lot, some things are unpredictable, but tomorrow you're going to be drinking liquids and eating foods. He said that's one of the things I can predict about next week. You will still be needing liquids and foods and probably using a toilet. So I said, oh, I can predict the future now. Right? No, actually, this is just a brief aside, but it was a little session. He charged me like $30 for this, but it's how to be a psychic at a party. How to be a psychic at a party. You wear a little red hat, kind of like Billy's, you know, or it's kind of like that, and you say stuff like, oh, let's see, you could use more money. He says, well, how'd you know? And then you say, you are looking for the love of your life. Well, how'd you know that? And then you have the gift of gab. Gary was really good at it. He made loads of money at parties. Then he would say stuff like political stuff. There's going to be rises and falls in the stock market.
Wow. Let me write that down.
There will be trouble in the Middle East. That was a classic one. Okay. Anyway, enough of that. You're always going to need some kind of food. You know, some of these companies in the 70s had all these food storage systems. They're still around, Mountain House and many others. You can give them $10,000 and they'll give you a year's supply of food and boxes and stuff. And some people buy that stuff. I don't encourage you to go there. I mean, if you have the money and you think you want to do that, you can. But there are a lot of more economical ways to buy food. What I recommend to people is kind of what Frank said. You put your excess money into it, buy a little bit extra each time. But you buy what you buy what you eat. You don't get some book that says about what the Mormons, you know, use for food storage. You store what you are normally eating. You make a list of your dietary needs and you buy that. Okay, all of you can do that. You
and
know
diversify.
What you eat.
Don't just buy beans because that gets really noisy. So you got different than corn, green beans, not just beans.
But how often? Okay, I had a book.
I like beans.
There was a very, very popular book by a woman named Elizabeth Dickey, I think. Was it Elizabeth Dickey? And she was a Mormon and she talked about the value of storing, among other things, wheat. Okay, and I read the book and I had hundreds of gallons of wheat, literally buckets. And then and 10 years later, I never used any. I don't usually use wheat. I don't usually grind it up.
Most people don't have a way to grind it up.
I traded a lot of it. I grew a lot of it. But I don't. And so I was thinking, how
soak
stupid.
It and sprout it.
It wasn't what I know I could, but I don't. Okay? So make a list of what you do eat and buy those things. It doesn't matter what Elizabeth Dickey said in her book. Okay? Yeah.
What you should do, too, is, you know, label those things when you bought them. So when you do rotate
good point.
What they are. People lose track. They think they're going to remember. But if you only buy a couple of cans or whatever it is extra every time you go to the market, it's pretty fat. You know, in a month's time, 2 months' time, you'd be amazed.
Yeah, you want to label it, so you eat the oldest stuff first.
I was going to mention that on your water containers, too. You just put a piece of tape on and mark the date.
This is really important to just keep a record so you know what you've got and when you got it. Use the oldest stuff first. Now, you know, store what you eat, buy the things that you eat, get as much as you can. 2 weeks is you can go through that in a hurry. Now, what's going to go first? The refrigerator. So that's your lower priority. You want to always think in terms of food that will last a long time. And I just brought some examples. This stuff is just powdered miso. Now, you can buy it in bulk. It's cheaper at Whole Foods to buy it in bulk. But this will last forever. You could take wild greens or other things that you have, and it flavors up a whole meal or makes a quick broth. Okay, so things like this. No refrigeration required. Beans. You know, this is not the economical way to buy beans, but I think Trader Joe sold this. I usually buy the gallons at various places, and you mix and blend them, and, you know, soak them in the morning so they're soft, and then you can cook them. You can make sprouts for salad, or you can have soups and whatever. So this doesn't require refrigeration. What it does require is you put it in a bottle. Don't keep it in the plastic bag because rats eat through these. Right? If you have it stored somewhere and you don't check it out, you want the rats to not get into it.
That's right.
Okay, and then you can buy now those little desiccant things to keep the food keep the bugs out, basically keeps it dry. The Top Ramen, which was on the news today, the students were complaining. You can buy five of these. Now, this isn't the most nutritious stuff in the world,
right.
But I guarantee you nobody's going to complain when there is no food.
Right.
You can add wild food to one of these and make a meal to serve 3 or 4 people. Right? You don't have to eat just this. So guess how much this was at the 99-cent store? Five for a dollar.
There you go.
So if you have a low budget, spend $20, and you have a week or two of just Top Ramen, and you can add it. And this is not the most nutritious thing in the world, but it's not the worst either. It's not a Twinkie. Yeah.
Popular scout meal is we take the Top Ramen shrimp flavor, and then you mix it with a little packet of tuna, Excellent.
Yeah.
Feeds 2 to 3 people.
Yeah, yeah.
Christopher, you got a question about those things that keep things fresh. Where do you buy those?
Who knows where those are? They're little. They're the things that you get when you have pills. Right. They're in there. I know Major Surplus has them, but I've seen them much more widely available.
Okay. The other question is: there any toxin in that you should be concerned about?
It's a drying agent. I don't think you'd want to eat the stuff.
But it
can be in direct contact with wheat and stuff. It's not a problem.
And I wonder how long they're good for, because you know they come in our vitamin bottles. Can we just save those?
You can reuse those. They're not.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say you can reuse them, but they might have a date on them. I don't know. I don't think they're good indefinitely.
It's just silica.
Silica just dried out.
Carbon.
Dry them out.
They get real hard. You know when they're real hard that they can't absorb
them. Other preserving agents and stuff.
Okay. They're good for 100 years.
Yeah, you know.
Good for 100 years.
100.
Okay, good. Good to know.
He's smiling.
Well, how old is that book?
Okay, stuff like this. This is microwavable pre-cooked rice. It's in a retort bag. So this, I don't know what the date on this is. It'll say best by April 30th, 2012. Mm. But most of these retort bags will last many years in storage. Okay, they do lose nutritional value, but it's not like they go bad, like getting moldy or something. So you can store these for a few years.
You don't want to buy a propane-powered microwave?
We're going to get into cooking in just a minute.
Oh, okay.
A propane-powered microwave?
Yeah.
There's a solar oven. There's a wood stove thing.
Also, if anybody has those...
I've got the name of it.
It sucks the air out of the vacuum thing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Food saver?
Yeah, food saver. We have one of those, but they work really good.
You guys have all heard of MREs, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Meals ready to eat, or in Dude's case, he calls them meals rejected by Ethiopians. which is true. They rejected them.
Christopher. Okay. I just want to get clear on what Gary just mentioned about a vacuum thing.
Okay, say it, Gary, again.
Food saver, we have one at home. They work really great. You can store packages of beans and things like that in it, and you can get them by bulk, so you can store what you want, and you can reuse the bag again too.
Little plastic bags and a vacuum packer, and so it just pulls out all the air.
Just sucks the air out.
So you get one of those.
Was I electrical?
Yeah, it's electric. So you have to do it ahead of time.
You do this ahead of time.
But you can preserve anything.
Yeah.
So meals, MREs are made for the military. And actually they have improved quite a bit.
Where do you buy those?
In recent years.
You can buy it at
when you
Target
go and you buy them,
Costco,
try to buy them on sale. Like when Major Surplus has a 50% off sale, which they do twice a year, I believe. Or other places do. I can usually get the entrees. This is not MRE, but it looks like an MRE. I can get them for like $1 a piece. And sometimes they're more pricier than that. But the fact is you've already paid for it with your tax dollars.
Yeah.
You guys know that, right? This is just the extra that they make, and then the military gets the current stuff.
Mm. Some of those MREs that you're seeing weren't made for the military in the first place. It'll say they're made to military specs,
okay,
and they're actually made for the commercial market.
You find them in backpacking stores or for Mormon stores and things like that. This is actually the same process. This is a retort bag. This is sold from Trader Joe. It's vegetarian Indian food. And it says eat by May 2012 also down here. But I've had them last longer than that. They're still fine. What'd you say? Is that a joke?
And you can warm those up in your car. Just put them in the dashboard.
Oh, yeah, yeah. On a hot day, put them on a rock.
Yeah.
You don't have to have a fire.
Hood.
Put them on your hood, yeah?
Yeah.
Palmdale, that's where we cook our eggs. Just on the rock and
I just assumed everybody cooked that way up in Palmdale. Right? I already knew that. Any kind of these candy bar things, they last practically forever. You know, chocolate almost doesn't go bad.
Right? It gets that white film.
But that's what chocolate does naturally. It's not gone bad. What's bad about a candy bar?
Empty calories?
The white sugar. Not the chocolate. The chocolate is a very good survival food. It actually gives you B vitamins. It gives you energy. It has a lot of things that our body needs. It's the white sugar that's bad.
That's the high percentage cocoa. 85% cocoa. Those are good.
That's right. So the dark chocolate that's popular now, some people may not like it because it's more bitter, but that's far better for you. What have you got there?
This is something that I've been using for the last year. It's called Think Thin. Mm-hmm. No sugar.
I just had one of those. They're good.
What's it called?
Think thin.
Thin.
I gotta do that.
From Trader Joe's?
You can get them at Trader Joe's. But most of them have.
I gotta get a picture of this.
Yeah. They have 20%. They have 20 grams of protein.
What does it taste
That's
like?
That's a cute picture of it.
Good.
Yeah, take a picture.
You gonna share it?
Huh?
You gonna share that?
No, I'm not gonna share it. But this is the nutty one. This one is just nuts. But it comes in a peanut butter. It comes in a brownie crunch, and they're good. But there's nothing in here that's
better. What is she laughing?
Well, she knows that I have part ownership of this company.
So here's I was at the 99-cent store and I got this. So there are evaporated milks that have loads and loads of bad ingredients. This has a few things, but it's mostly milk. Some of them are just like junk, really junk food. But this will last for a couple of years. Yes, question.
Another thing, if you milk is soy milk, the sealed containers of soy milk will last 6 months without being refrigerated.
So will the rice milk.
Almond milk.
Well, the retort boxes you're talking about,
rice.
Right?
One of the non-dairy milks, they're good too.
Yeah, those.
Well, you can store powdered milk if you have butter.
Yeah.
So, you should, just in terms of what you store in your home, get the things that you eat, get them in bulk, you know, or that your family members eat, and think non-refrigeration. So, canned goods, dried goods, retort pouches, anything that's pickled, not all things, but most things that are pickled, you know, because pickling and salting are and dried foods, and they're all traditional methods of storage, food storage.
The thing that you can make, a couple of years ago at one of our dirt time events, I did a demonstration of what they call the zeer pot. And a zeer pot, you need to have flower pots. And they can't be lined or anything. And you take the big one, you take it up a bigger size, another one goes inside of it, you line it with wet sand.
Here's a visual aid.
Yeah, there you go.
A guy in Africa received like some Nobel Prize or something for coming up with this. It wasn't a Nobel Prize, it was
some prize.
Yeah. It's a pot within a pot with sand in between.
Yeah.
It's an evaporative cooler.
And what you do, and then you cover the top with a wet cloth. I've kept apples, that's not a good example, tomatoes go bad fast. I've had tomatoes in one of these, and they've lasted for 2 weeks.
And you wet the sand, right?
You keep water in the sand.
You make sure it's continually damp. And it absolutely works. And if you can get it in a slight breeze, keep it in the shade, get it in a slight breeze, it works fantastic.
And you want non-glazed pots for this.
That's the word I was looking for.
Yeah, non-glazed. Yeah.
Like an earthenware.
Pass that around so everybody can see it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It really works fantastic.
No Impact Man tried that. Tried using
the same
blade. Who did?
No Impact Man.
Who's that's a person?
Yeah.
No Impact Man, but I don't know.
No Impact Man?
Yeah, it's a documentary guy did where he tried to do
meats and stuff too, right?
What's that?
He tried to do more than just produce.
Yeah. Yeah.
And yeah, you can, I mean,
try to use that.
Oh, that's that documentary from New York?
Yeah.
New York? Yeah, that's right.
So traditionally, people dried meats like Native Americans by drying them.
Right.
You didn't have refrigeration. You did pickle or you dried the stuff. That's what jerky was, dried meat. Pemmican was dried meat with some sugar added to it. Not salted, sugar.
Well, pemmican, they added fruit.
That's what I said, sugar.
Oh, okay. Different kind of sugar.
Right, fruit sugar, just the actual dried, crystallized fruit.
Well, more than fruit sugar, the fruit itself.
Well, that's what I said. We're all saying the same thing.
Well, we want to be careful about that word sugar.
Well, know. I mean, when I say they added sugar to the meat for preservation that they added to it, so I didn't mean they added white sugar. They didn't have white sugar. But white sugar, it's an interesting modern phenomenon. In the past, people did use all kind of natural sugars that they made themselves for preservation or for you know, for
so
the
when
flavor.
When you separate out the stuff, you see fructose added to something. That's separated out from
I know.
The fruit.
That's a
really
processed product. I know some of it's really bad.
Honey doesn't go bad.
Honey never goes bad.
Yeah.
Honey never goes bad. And it doesn't get moldy.
Yeah.
It has not enough water to get moldy. So old honey, it crystallizes, it gets hard, it's not bad.
Just heat it up, right?
You could heat it up or just scoop it or cut it out, or just scrape it out, depending what kind of container it's in. So honey lasts basically forever.
And it's medicine, too.
You can use it on wounds to stop infections.
That's good.
Well, what kind of sugar does honey have in it?
Honey is, okay, it's something that ends in O-S-E.
Yeah.
Okay, I can say that much. Yeah. It's an OSE. But I'm not really up on all the chemistry of sugar, but like lactose is milk sugar, maltose is malt sugar, fructose is fruit, sucrose is the white sugar that's processed. But the bees harvest the nectar out of the flowers. That's flower nectar that they swallow, regurgitate, and dehydrate in their cells, and that's honey. It's not a bee product in the sense of an animal product, like a cow produces milk. It's not really like that. They've taken the nectar and dehydrated it. That's all it is.
What's good about honey, too, is it's easier on your pancreas because other sugars, they get into your system, and it's a shock to your system because you get sugar into your system real quick. Honey is a more complex sugar, which takes it longer to digest, and it's easier because it goes into your system slower, so it's not as much of a shock to your system. So honey's a good thing.
There are even cookbooks on how to cook with honey because it's not quite the same as using white sugar, yeah. Which is most cookbooks are, like Martha Stewart's cookbook and probably Gloria, what's her name? Gloria Child. Gloria, what's her name?
Julia Child.
Julia Child. You know, all that's about white sugar.
I read about it.
So you have to do it a little bit different. You use, which method did you say you prefer when you do your cooking? Is it Julia Child's or?
No, I like Martha's too.
You prefer Martha. Okay. Okay, so besides things that you've stored, like Dude did at his home, and I know a lot of you do, when you have landscaping in your yard, assuming you're not in an apartment, you know, you can read Home Magazine or whatever the magazine is in the Times about gardening, about what the gardeners say is in this month, and you could do that, or you can just go to the nursery and always buy fruit trees. You don't need anything in your yard that's not useful.
Everything planted around my yard is either edible or usable to me somehow.
Yeah, great. If it's not, sometimes things I like that are, I kept a tobacco tree in the yard, native tobacco, because it draws hummingbirds, and I can use it as a poison for insects if I wanted to.
And it eats the hummingbirds.
No, I really don't. And I don't smoke the leaves anymore, either.
Take out that grass lawn and plant something useful.
Everything that you plant in your yard, it could be like a mini farm. And there is kind of a trend to not do the lawns. If you're in San Marino, they'll run you out of town, though. Because some places, they say you're going to lower the guys like Frank will lower the property values.
I would never do that.
You know, and then they're going to get you out of there. But everything that you grow can be useful. You just make that choice. So then if there is an emergency, you have... If it's in season or whatever, you might have herbs, you might have some vegetables, you might have... And there's a lot of ornamental-seeming things that provide year-round food. For example, instead of a lawn, I don't have any with me today, but I've always used New Zealand spinach. It's a perennial spinach that provides year-round greens. You could have nasturtiums, you could have mints, you could have all these kind of herbs. So that's one way you can always have something. Maybe not everything. I mean, if you're not living on many acres, you can't get everything. But you have some of the things that you need. So fruit trees, and of course, we're going to look at wild things today when we do our walk. Remember Clint that came from Modesto?
Oh, yeah.
He was a real character.
Is that Eastwood?
Not Clint Eastwood. No. I forgot his last name. We just called him Clint of Modesto.
One of the things about lawns, going back to that for a minute, is probably one of the single biggest polluters in the country. Because people pour all this liquid fertilizer on it, weed killers on it. When you take... The yardage, the square miles of lawns clear across the United States, it's probably doing more to harm our water system than anything. And I'm not like a tree hugger guy or anything, but it's amazing what happens with lawns.
And they're using all the water too.
Because George Washington had a lawn.
Did he?
Yeah, he copied the English. He was English.
Well, even the English, the castle owners. Have started finding ways to have low maintenance lawns.
I do that with my castle.
Is that right?
Yeah.
That's what I figured.
I took the moat out too.
You took the moat out.
But they get a lot of rain over there. They get a lot of rain there, so that's a whole different thing.
They get a lot more rain here in Southern California.
But regardless, why not be practical and grow something?
Yeah.
You don't have a lawn, do you?
Yeah.
Why don't you take it out? I'll write a note to you.
Because Danny won't let him.
I have a.
You may not be able to.
Another side of my family.
In some areas. There's a convention.
I got a citation because the grass wasn't green.
Like I said, some areas, some areas you need to do that. Any other questions on food?
In a desert.
Yeah.
That's ridiculous.
Here are a few things I'll show you before we'll go on to food cooking. But I picked a few things. Some of you may know them, some of you may not. But what is this guy?
Lamb's quarter.
Lamb, okay, did you know that, what this is?
I don't remember.
Okay, this is the green lamb's quarter, the white lamb's quarter. I guarantee you that if you don't have a gardener, you have this in your yard, if you have a yard. Right? This isn't everybody, this is very common in worldwide. It's originally from Europe, but now it's all over North America. Both of them make good for salad, good for soups. You have your top ramen, you get all these leaves, and you chop it up, and you have enough for two or three people, not just yourself.
It's more nutritious than spinach.
Yeah, far more nutritious than spinach.
Non-native, but still good.
Yeah. Pass it around.
How do you tell the difference between the white and the black and the green and the yellow?
Okay, the way you tell the difference, Billy, is you study them.
Oh.
The stem.
Is there someone local that could teach us these things?
That's why Dude came today. No, but you just look at them. See, the white, that one is glossy, whereas the white one kind of has a white mealiness over it. Now, both the white and the green are edible. They're both very common. Probably the white is more common. And you notice there's more red in the green. I mean, you should be able to see the difference. The leaves of the green are a little bit more pointy. We are going to walk around and see these things, but I just wanted to make the point that the stuff in your yard that you didn't even grow is also a source of food once you get to know them. This is everywhere this year.
It's a Montebello.
Jorge knows what this is, right?
I do, but I'd like to knowledge.
That's big of you.
Everyone too.
Yeah, that's
give everybody a chance, right?
You took it back. Mallow, right. Mallow, as in marshmallow. There's your typical leaf. It's a little more fibrous. So this is also doubles as a medicinal plant. When you have a cough or a sore throat, in the Mexican curandero shops, they sell this as malva, M-A-L-V-A. You make it into a tea or you chew on it and it soothes the throat. Otherwise, you can eat it raw or you cook it. And the little fruits, which there may be a few on, can be eaten as well. And I brought a bunch of this. I'm not sure what all we'll find today.
And is it all right to eat a lot of it?
Like, what do you mean by a lot?
Massive, you know.
Massive amount.
Like every day, like that, like at least that much every day.
I don't know of any harm that would come from this, from just eating what I would call normal amounts in salad or as a cooked green. There aren't any toxins that I'm aware of in mallow.
Like the same amount you would eat your other greens, right?
I don't doubt that there are some plants that we eat all the time, even things that you're used to eating. If you eat a large amount and nothing else, there might be some sickness that will result, vomiting.
It's a good idea to rotate anyway.
But I'm just talking normal amounts, yes.
I have a question about nasturtiums.
Yes.
Actually, how long does it usually take for it to seed when you grow it?
Okay, you're asking about nasturtium, which is this plant, which is native to the West Coast, has a large round leaf. If you guys want to sample a little bit, it's very spicy. Nasturtium? Yeah, nasturtium. This is nasturtium. Looks like a big water lily. Grows along the beaches, and everything above ground can be. So after the rains, like about December, it starts to come up, and then it has its flowers. It
has flowers like this?
Yeah, there are the flowers. Good.
Well, because I planted some, but it hasn't been growing at all.
Did it sprout up yet?
How long ago
did this? So you didn't want to know
3 weeks ago.
3 weeks ago?
Yeah.
It should still come up. Yeah. It's a very easy thing to grow.
So I had a
it doesn't like all conditions, though. So. It doesn't like all conditions.
Yeah.
It won't grow every
place. If it's really dry, it may not do well.
So does that take away?
Pardon?
I planted it in like a pot or something like that, so keep it
How you doing, Ted?
Well, I don't know about real wet, but it does like damp.
Hey, guess what? Ted, he's in my book, too. Let's see if I can. I'm gonna read a quote from you, Ted. You knew I was here, right?
I saw
these plants over here. Okay, hold on, Ted. Hold on. Let's see if I can find him. You knew I was going to read from your quote, right,
Ted? Yeah, thank you.
Okay,
I appreciate you. Doing that.
Okay. Do you still do the house tours?
What is this?
How come I can't find you when I want you?
What's the house tour?
I built a house. It's pretty green. It's in, it's got a lot of solar and all the green things that you can imagine in it, from composting to drought tolerance. But he included me a little bit of my stuff in there.
Okay, this is from Ted Baumgart. Hi.
Hi.
This is Catherine Williams.
Hi, Catherine. Ted has a some solar panels and it runs his refrigerator. It's a thick-walled refrigerator. He pointed out to me that the refrigerator is the biggest energy hog in the household. I realized that the refrigerator was the power hog, so I read everything I could find as an alternative, says Baumgart. I read Mother Earth News, Farm News, and anything I'd get my hands on. Then I learned about Larry Schussler in Arcata, California, who was manufacturing a refrigerator that's 5 times more efficient than anything else on the market. That's a SunFrost, right?
Yes, it is.
But it's no longer made, is it?
It is made.
It is still made. Okay, the SunFrost.
Relative, yeah.
Schussler's SunFrost refrigerators are made to run on 12 and 24 volts DC. They have the motors mounted on the top, and they have 4 inches of insulation in places. The refrigerators are nuts, and it goes on and on about that, etc. So that's good. Thank you for coming by. Visitors almost automatically ask me if I'm off the grid, says Baumgart. He explains that he is not off the grid because he'd have to cut down so many trees that he loves. So everything is a balance, right? He could be off the grid, but he'd have to cut all the big oak trees around his house.
But if we cut the tree, we need air conditioning in the summer.
Or you could paint the roof white.
Yeah, that's part of it.
No, I think the trees are better.
The tree's much better.
It's actually a Mediterranean tree, a level of pine.
Oh, that's
so much more benefit. It's a microclimate. It brings a lot of other critters, birds, and whatnot.
So trees are natural air conditioners.
Yeah.
Okay, I feel a little closer to Mother Nature, says Baumgart, about his conversion to solar power. I didn't want to pollute, and I didn't like the way things were going, so this is what I had to do. Plus, I'm a lifelong do-it-yourselfer. This was not a choice for me. I had to do this. But I'll pass this around. The famous Ted Baumgart.
And by the way, I'm still
good to see you, buddy.
And she is my better half.
Yeah,
we did that with Cam Stone, who instigated that Arcadia thing.
I wasn't fishing for an
Wow.
Yeah.
So I missed.
Yes.
I would love to.
So the nasturtium, you can eat the leaves.
You can eat the leaves, the stems, every part of the nasturtium you can eat.
The flower.
I've never had
to. Every part of it, stem and all.
And the flower, too.
And the flower, that's like the radish.
All of it is.
Okay. I think because of the time, I'm going to move into just alternatives to cooking, okay? You guys, have you all looked at the solar oven? That solar oven, it's probably not in the sun right now, but that one you can get, there used to be like $200 new. Let's just go take a look at it. Now,
you mean you can cook with the sun with that?
Of course, let me put it in the sun. Now, normally, this is a commercial one. Okay, this used to run about $200, but I've seen them for a little over 100, and I've seen them used. You've got a thermometer. See, it's 100 degrees right now. You have a little door. You open and close it, and the reflectors really help. Usually, you can adjust it to the sun. But with this one, it's almost as good as using the gas range on a day like today. You'll see that thermometer go up real quick. I've cooked potatoes, soup, enchiladas, all kind of stuff, eggs in here. It virtually cannot burn, but it will dry out.
What's the highest temperature you've got?
I've gotten 350 with this.
Wow.
So cooking on this is almost like cooking on the stovetop on a day like today.
350 is an average baking.
Wow. Did you buy? How much did this cost?
I did not make this. My skills are not quite at that level. I bought it before 1999, before the year 2000. They normally ran about $200. And after 2000, in the year January, February, when the world didn't come to an end, from Y2K, I got this for like $50 or $60, I don't remember. So people were getting rid of a lot of stuff because they realized the world wasn't going to end as abruptly as they thought. But normally, it's about $100 from the company that makes it. I think the retail is $175, but you can pick them up for about $100. Eventually, I'll put them on my website. People can get them. Now, see, the temperature's already gone up 50 degrees or so.
Wow.
Or 50? No, maybe 20 degrees. And you've got a little swivel in here, depending on the height that you have it in relation to the sun, to keep the pan flat. So you always want to have things in black containers, ideally to absorb the heat. And you, if you have potatoes, you cut them into small bits. If you have MREs, you can lay your MRE packs in there, or your pot of soup, or whatever. But you do need to plan ahead with solar cookers. Plan an hour or so. Again, as Gary says, it's predictable that people will eat every day. So you eat around lunchtime, so you plan about 10:30 or 11 for lunch. And, you can plan ahead. you need a south-facing area to put these. One of the reasons why some people don't use these is they're afraid that somebody's going to come and steal it if they're not watching the food all the time, like indoors. So that all depends on your particular situation. So I'll leave this here in the sun. We'll come back and see how it's prepared. Now, come over here for a minute. This stove all fits into this bag. But if you have a barbecue in your yard, you're fine. I have an outside barbecue that I got out of the trash that I never bought. So old scrap wood is all that you would need for cooking. This was a guy in Pasadena who invented this thing. So you can have it in your car, and if you have some, you know, cooking supplies, you can cook with it. And you can see how quickly it pardon me? I haven't used it in a while. Okay, let me see. This goes here.
You're saving it for the big one.
No, I use it sometimes, but it's just kept on the floor in my kitchen.
Well, that's one thing that's good too, is to know how to use your equipment, because in an emergency you're under more stress.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. How do we use? I'm trying to remember how to put the whole thing together. This goes. This is your top. Well, maybe this goes right here, huh?
Mm-hmm.
That slides in there.
Maybe.
I don't know.
What's that paper that comes with it? Is that instructions?
Instructions! Hey! You don't expect us to read the instructions, do you?
Are you filming him doing that?
Mm-hmm. Are you trying to embarrass me?
Well, I need a bloopers reel.
Okay. Yeah,
he's got
okay, there you go.
There
you go. So, you put your fire in here. Now, I used to wrap the inside with tinfoil so it doesn't wear out as rapidly. And then you could just cook right in there, put something over it, or this is if you want to make an oven. Okay, so it's a real simple cooking. So the actual place where you're cooking is in there, and all the ashes will fall through, so you have a bit of an airflow, right? You just put your stuff in there. It, effectively, you make your fire right in there.
Okay. They have the steak cooking right on top.
Okay, so that's okay.
You can do it both ways.
Okay, let's try it again. Okay, that fits in there. That makes more sense, doesn't it, Billy?
Yeah.
Okay, so there's where you cook. Okay.
And there's your oven.
When all else fails, read the instructions. So you can use it. That makes a lot more sense. So you can put your pot or whatever right there.
Cool.
I've seen them online. I don't even know if they're still made.
Oh, yeah.
It's called the Pyramid.
Cold.
Yeah. Some guy in Pasadena.
Your coals go on that tray right there.
The coals go on the tray, okay. Now, I'm not necessarily recommending this product, but there are a lot of compact stove type things you can buy. The thing about this compared to your conventional camping stoves is that they require, fuel of some sort, gas or whatever. Whereas this, you can literally just put, I've never used charcoal. I may have used charcoal once, but you just get twigs from the yard and you have your fire. You want to think in terms of something that you can refresh when you run out of the fuel. So this you can use with just about anything. Put grass in there and it'll, heat up enough to boil water. Okay. Yeah, so you can put one of the little military fuel tabs in there and heat it up that way. So, okay, so again, the point is you've got all your food and your water stored. You're going to have meals you can eat at least once a day. How are you going to cook it? So you have solar cookers, you have something like this, and of course if the stove is working, use the stove.
Or right? Just eat raw food.
There are people that like all raw food, although Frank says you don't digest the food as well if it's all raw. Mm-hmm. I don't argue with him about it. Like I say, I paid about $60 or $70 for it, but if you go online, you can probably find it from $200 to $150 or so. Yeah. These last for a long, long time.
How long does it take to boil water?
How long does it take? Depends on the air temperature. It depends on the air temperature of how long it takes for the temperature to get up to that. It boils at about 212 degrees.
Okay.
So it could take, on your stove, it takes, a couple minutes? Depending on the heat of the day, it could take shorter or longer. I don't know. Frank has the technical answer in terms of how many calories it takes to convert the et cetera to the et cetera.
That depends on how much water you're trying to boil.
That's the British thermal unit, how many calories it takes to raise a 1 pound of water 1 inch.
There you go. 1 inch? One degree.
Oh, where'd the sled dogs come
from? I don't know what's going on.
I just made that up.
That's good.
It's dirty and it's strong stuff, man.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Toilet alternatives. You should all think about a toilet alternative. I cover a lot of that in here. But of course, the simplest thing that I would recommend for an emergency is what? Is get a porta potty. You can usually get them at yard sales or estate sales because people don't want them, like a hospital porta potty. And it's just and just find a way to empty it. I lived at a place once. I know people are shocked when I tell them this, but I was a squatter for a year and a half at a place, at a house in L.A. in a large estate, which yes means I broke in, and I had the locks changed. Oh my God! You got edited. I forgot Billy was taping. What I meant to say is Jorge here.
We knew someone.
Yeah, we knew someone. Okay, no, something like that. No, actually, I've written about it, so it's not a big deal. Well, maybe it is. If the DA sees this.
Just don't give the address.
You've been forgiven.
Okay. We did experiments with toilets, and one of the first things we did was go to a place, I think it was Big Five, and buy their camping toilet, which is nothing but a 5-gallon bucket in an outer bucket with a seat. Okay? And then they give you that blue stuff to use. Now, in a long-term emergency, you use up that blue stuff, which is a disinfectant. So we experimented with ways to keep the smell down, right? Because if you're in a bomb shelter, you can't go outside. That's a concern. We used baking soda and lemon juice and tried different experiments, but it turned out, in terms of what would be readily available in an emergency for a long period of time, the best product was what?
Ashes.
Ashes, which was chemically very similar to baking soda. We just used a little bit of wood ashes in the toilet after it was used each time. We have a friend,
You kept this outside?
No, it was kept in the bathroom.
Oh, in the bathroom?
We did it in the bathroom.
Oh, okay.
And we had about a month or so experiment. I even told guests, we're not using the toilet this month. We want to see if this really works. I lived with two other people at the time.
Yeah.
And so the bad part was, you know, whose job it was to empty it before it was full.
How often did you have to empty it?
When it was full. It varied,
okay.
But generally every 3 or 4 days.
Yeah, okay.
And we had a trench in the yard that we would dump it into. We dug it for that use. Then we put soil over it and straw.
So an apartment dweller would have a little more concern. An
apartment dweller would have to figure something else out. Right. Even in an apartment, sometimes there's some space.
Vacant lot or
but
something.
But think about that. If you're in an apartment, if people, this is, as Gary says, you can predict that people will need to, they need to use a bathroom. So you need to handle that if the plumbing doesn't work. That's a normal biological function. You need to handle it. And so you just need to deal with it in your place. So we dug a trench, buried it, and it probably took, that trench didn't fill up in the whole month. Okay, and eventually I planted tomatoes over there. Tomatoes do well on sewage. It's the one crop that can grow practically in fresh compost. So that worked. That basically worked pretty well. Just using the bucket and emptying everything and washing it out. So wood ash people have a good supply. Porta potties work well. You know, there's a fellow named Christian who is part of some community in Connecticut, I think, and he said that they didn't want to use any water in their toilet system, so they built. You know, there are commercial compost toilets you can buy. They have to be plugged in usually. Or if they're big enough, they don't require electricity. Now, they generally run about almost $1,000 for the good ones. You guys are familiar with that, right? There are quite a few compost toilets. What's the big one? There's Clevis Multrum is one of the companies that's been around for a long time. But there are a lot of them, and you see them advertised in Mother Earth News and Countryside Magazine. And they're okay, but my friend Christian said that we didn't even want to plug something in. And they found that they had an outhouse that they converted so that they can open up the back and clean it out, okay? And they just had everybody put sawdust in each time after they used it. And that, they said there was no smell. Sawdust was perfect. Sometimes they did put ash in.
Yeah, we use cedar bark up in
same
the mouth.
Thing.
It, no smell, same, yeah. And it goes right out
that
to the vegetable
be
garden.
That would probably be better because of the aromatic oils in the cedar.
Yeah.
Did you have to clean that one out? Like,
I think every few months it's cleaned out and just hauled out to the vegetable garden.
You know, and it's something that you do want to consider, because people like to think about all the good foods and stuff you can store, but you know, you do go to the bathroom, somebody has to deal with it, and you're gonna, you'd rather think about it before than after. And store toilet paper. You know, go to the 99-cent store or whatever. You will go through a lot of toilet paper, especially in an emergency. If you have cuts or wounds or things, you'll end up using it all. It's just wood pulp, so it decomposes well.
I just want to remind, we'd use about a cup, a good-sized cup full or a big handful. It's powdered up, you know, kind of really fibered, you know, not pieces of bark, right? Just a cup full, that's it.
Any questions on that? I mean, it's actually pretty basic. I have a whole chapter in there on different things people have done, but, you know, is that kind of clear?
Does any place sell wood ash? Because, you know, us in apartments, we can't burn campfires or fireplaces and stuff.
Does anybody sell wood ash? I mean, it seems like...
Probably buy sawdust, though.
I think it's lime. You could use lime, too.
You could use lime, yeah. You could buy lime.
Sawdust you could probably buy.
Sawdust you could buy, but, you know, I have friends who are wood... workers, and they usually call me. I've got five big bags of sawdust, and usually people are happy to give it to you if you make it known that you want it.
Yeah.
But that's the thing. In an emergency, right? It's whatever you have stored. In an emergency, you may not be able to get it. I would store baking soda, I guess. You know, that comes in handy for a lot of things. Toilet paper, of course.
Baking soda is good for toothpaste.
That's what I use.
I think camping is a good experience because I'm a Boy Scout leader, so a lot of the boys, when they camp, they learn how to cook for themselves out in the woods. They learn how to use the restroom and figure all that out, you know, because if you've never done it, you know, use the restroom without like a flushable toilet, you kind of learn stuff, you know, if you do it. And one of the things that is helpful for us is those wipes. They don't cost much, you know, those baby wipes.
Right. They're moist.
Yeah.
Sure.
So that works really good.
For wounds or for all sorts of things. By the way, like my mother grew up on a farm, and that was pre-plumbing. They didn't have indoor plumbing. She told me when her brothers, they put the kitchen sink in the kitchen, and that was a big deal, like in 1940 or so, you know. And that was not... So we are about a couple of generations away from... when everybody just knew how to do this stuff automatically.
They've lost the skills.
Yeah, we just don't do it anymore. Dude probably remembers when everybody used an outhouse, right,
that's
dude?
True. Yeah. I still use an outhouse, depending where I'm at.
Well, know. Me too.
We go sometimes. Camping or whatever, yeah.
But when you grew up, there was plumbing, though, wasn't there?
As a Roman,
I can't even say
plumbing.
Yeah, but you use lead pipes.
Yeah, lead pipes is terrible.
Okay.
Dude,
okay.
When Rome fell, what did you do?
I fiddled. I was that guy. I changed my name.
Okay, I'm going to cover some simple things if there's no electricity. Now, I don't want to, I'm not going to get into like all how to rewire your house for solar powering, because there are, if you're interested in that, go get Real Goods catalog. Real Goods. Anybody not familiar with them? It's a pricey way to buy all your solar gadgets that you want. But for an education about how to actually do solar rewiring of your home, you pay $5 for their full catalog, and it's quite an education on solar water heating, what it really takes, what works, what doesn't work, how to size a system for solar electricity. Okay, what works, what doesn't work. I cover the basics in that book. But simple things that you can do. The main thing that you need if the power goes out is lighting. So don't overlook candles. You know, this is a great candle. It's all beeswax. It has a thick wick. When I'm done, I can just put this on. It's amazing how much light this little guy gives off.
And beeswax candles last longer than
paraffin.
Yeah. Radio.
When you go to estate sales and yard sales, it's amazing how often people sell candles. Nobody wants them. Buy those. They're cheap. Even I have a friend, when we had a local blackout, and my house was all lit, you know, and I had candles and lanterns and Aladdin lamps and all that stuff. And this guy was living with me at the time, and he said he knew there was a blackout, and he went to Thrifty at the time to get candles. All the candles were sold out within minutes because people waited till afterwards. And the decorative candles, they doubled in price because they knew people would buy them.
churches.
Rob the church, is that what you're saying?
They use fresh corn. Yeah.
Sorry. I didn't mean to. Please edit that from the video.
Yeah.
Please deduct that. What was the question?
They put new candles every Sunday in the church, and they take the old ones. They've burnt down a bit, and they typically get thrown away.
Seriously?
Yeah.
In the little votive candles? Little votive candle things?
And also the 99-cent store is a gold mine for candles.
Yeah, yeah.
They have them in glasses. They have, like, you know, religious things on them. They're that high. Mm-hmm. They're 99 cents.
Yeah, some of them have pollutants in them, too, you might want to be aware of.
Yeah, you got the chemicals.
The what's in them?
Pollutants.
Pollutants.
Yeah, they put chemicals in
them. Well, I need a bunch of beeswax when I make candles.
Yeah, you're burning something, but light makes a big difference. I mean, I'm sure you've all experienced there's no light. You know, you can live without your computer. You can live without the Brady Bunch or whatever you're watching, or two guys without a boy. What's it called? Two men?
I don't know.
Two and a half men.
Crazy guy to
has no socially redeeming value, so it's good that it's off the air.
That's right.
You know, you can live with... Well, you
reruns.
Want,
there's huh? reruns, I got
it. Reruns, oh my God. But you can live without a lot of this stuff, but things like refrigeration, it's going to hurt you. So that's why you try to have food stored another way. But lighting one way is, whose lantern is that? That's yours. Is it a fuel lantern?
Yes, but it doesn't have kerosene because kerosene stinks.
No, it doesn't. Add a drop of vanilla.
Oh, okay. Well, no.
So it does if you add the vanilla. You might have hurt his feelings by the way you said that.
No, it's okay.
You do have kerosene in the tank, put one drop of vanilla and it smells like you're eating vanilla ice cream.
But I use something called liquid candle. And it works great. And indoors, it doesn't smoke up the house or anything.
So for short-term emergencies,
yeah.
Even a week
and
or
it's
two,
pretty bright.
You can get lights like this.
Mm-hmm. The stuff spilled in the back of my truck, so it's kind of empty. Right
these
now.
Things. What do you guys think of these flashlights, battery-less flashlights?
Good, but they break easy.
Do they?
Well, I've had a couple. Don't work anymore.
You shake it back and forth through this coiled copper. And it produces a bit of an electrical charge. And I don't even know if this is working anymore.
Did that just start playing because it solar charged it up or something?
Oh, this is... Yeah, this is the solar panel.
Funny.
So this one, I had... This one you can crank, by the way. Communication is important. Now, this is just to get the news for an emergency. So this will work in the sun. I didn't realize it was on. But I can crank it if it's nighttime, and it takes about a crank every 35 minutes. To keep the radio going. So these kind of devices are good also.
I think that's an important aspect of survival as well, and calming down your fear. Like what Mr. McLean was saying, the sense of panic, having a lit candle, having a lighted house, brings a comfort to the mind. And I think that's important, especially in an emergency. You know, if you know that the power line's going to be down for a week, at least we have light, the family, we can gather around the candle, gather on the lantern, we have a radio, we can listen to music or news updates. That has a lot to do with survival as well, I think.
Be aware of gas leaks if you're going to light anything, though.
That's
a candle, a flame, or anything.
Now, what I wanted to show you are some of the ways... Okay, lighting is important. Get candles, get lanterns. Whether it's battery-operated, gas-operated, you should have plenty of them. Many of the things you should still be able to do in an emergency, but I remember a friend visit. This is my friend Nathaniel told me this. He was visiting these friends in college, three girls in an apartment,
and
there was a power outage in San Francisco, and they were going to cook some food, but everything was in cans. They only had an electric can opener.
Wow! Oh my God!
And my friend Nathaniel put out a Swiss Army knife and proceeded to open up their cans for them. So they could not. Here's it. Like here, you have a little can opener on that.
Right.
But get a manual can opener. You know, they're not expensive. Don't buy the cheap one. You know, just get the swing away. Get a good one. There are a couple. What I mean by that is there are cheap ones, and they're all relatively cheap. Or you go to that fancy food place in Colorado, Sur La Table or whatever.
Oh yeah.
I mean, at least the can opener will last you forever. I have a $30 can opener. People laugh. What do you need to pay $30 for? It doesn't go bad.
I used to have the cheap can openers, and they strip the gears. And
that's right. They don't last.
Opener.
Yeah, that's right. They don't last forever.
But if you lost
it, a fortune for a can opener. But you will use that thing.
If you lost it, you can't use it. Get a screwdriver or use your knife, or you can get the can open.
Right.
But a hammer works wonderful.
You don't want just all electric households may have sounded great in the 50s. But that's not really the way to go if it's things that, you know, you can't do otherwise. You can make juice. See, I don't have an electric juicer. Some people don't even know what those are anymore.
Yeah, I love those things.
Yeah.
There's a my, that's my food processor. That thing right there. See that, Jim? Hold that up. That's my food processor. Right there. And that's my food processor too. That thing right there. The garlic press. That could be my food processor, but
this is the most essential.
Yeah, dude and I don't eat the same. So maybe you held it up, thinking of the way he. Okay, now this is my coffee grinder.
I
actually do have a little electric one that's very efficient, but I've used this, you know, many, many times. This is the old-fashioned ones that were made in South Pasadena.
Wow.
Most of the modern ones are junk. But I over the years, I've had three or four of this exact model made by the Thompson Company in South Pasadena.
Wow.
Would that work?
I thought that was a music recorder that did.
Not acorns. No. I have meat grinders manual meat grinders and wheat grinders that I use for acorns. Usually, one of the acorns are wet and leached, I run them through a meat grinder. So it's still a manual device, yeah.
I was looking for a grinder one day, and my aunt said, go to East LA and get a corn grinder.
Corn grinder. Manual corn grinder.
Yeah, it's like, I don't know what it's made out of, but it's like shiny.
Aluminum, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it works great, and it's heavy duty, man. It looks expensive, even clamps on the table. It has a vice thing, clamps on the table.
I have a,
that
I
looks
didn't
really
bring
good.
It. I could have brought boxes of stuff to try to impress you, but I'm not really trying to impress you. I'm just kidding. There's a lot of ideas out there. I have a crank device that looks like a wheat grinder that you see at the farmer's market sometimes for making wheat bread, which Frank likes to call swamp juice. You know, they give you the little ounce of the green liquid, and you go, you know, when you drink it, but it's very nutritious. But there is a hand crank juicer. Now, you can take backyard grasses, because all grasses are edible, so you don't use the poisons on them, and run grasses through your wheatgrass juicer and make your own juice. I've done it many times. It's delicious, depending on the grass. And you know, fiber comes out and your juice comes out. So that's a way. I've often thought, I know this is kind of odd, but sometimes if there's elderly people and they can't eat stuff, you get the meat grinder to reduce stuff to somebody with no teeth, because in an emergency situation, you know, it's not just strong, fit guys like Billy and Frank. You know, that are going to be surviving. There are people that are elderly that might have eating difficulties. So like baby food, you might have to think about storing that. But I got the grass grinder thinking that somebody in the household, if they couldn't eat regular food, you could get them fresh vitamins by processing grass and giving them that juice tea, or doing that with meat as well. So those kind of devices, you go to any swap meet or flea market and you get them for nothing. You know, get the meat grinders for $10 because nobody wants them or uses them anymore.
So what do you do with the acorn meal? You just soak the seed, the acorns, and then...
First off, you want to come to the acorn class.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
The whole class?
But what you... No, we do a whole class on it. But basically... Oh, and Billy, under Billy Goat 2x4, right?
4x4.
Billy Goat 4x4. On YouTube, he videotaped the whole class.
Okay.
It's like an hour, right?
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
So we were here grinding, shelling the acorns, grinding them, pouring the water through them, getting all the tannic acid out. But there's a number of ways you can do it. I didn't actually watch it all. Figured I was here, I know what it's about.
Yeah.
But there were two basic ways we did it. And the bottom line is you cook the acorns to get the tannic acid out. Then you use it as a flour for bread or biscuits or pancakes or whatever.
Wow.
We made pancakes that day. Maybe biscuits too, I don't remember.
So is this what you use for that?
No. No, this is a coffee grinder.
Oh, coffee.
To grind the acorns, I used a traditional metate from Alvera Street.
Okay.
And I also used molcajetes, which is the bowl one. And I used a meat grinder. So I didn't bring any of those today. Okay. So all of your kitchen stuff that's all electric, you should have manual counterparts, just to be smart, just to have stuff that can do simple processing. Okay, electricity.
Percolator. Coffee percolator.
Oh, yeah. For when I make coffee, I just have a cone and I pour the water through. somebody told me to make some coffee. I was at a county facility, not a prison. I mean, it was a park, a county facility. That doesn't sound good, does it?
Learned a lot about you today.
I was at a public park, and they said, can you make some coffee? And I actually didn't know how to use it.
Why would you stay not a prison? Because you're guilty?
No, when you say county facility, it just suddenly it sounded wrong. It sounded like those places that you and Gary are always at. Isn't that when you guys met? You were cellmates?
That's right.
Okay.
We were cellmates.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, anyway, these devices, like this device here, is a little solar. Now, it doesn't matter if you write the company name down because this company doesn't exist, but I bought these used on eBay. So I can power something. This has a little jack, but I could power, in this case, I have a battery charger. Put my batteries in there, and I can actually power them with the sun. Oh no, I have to do. What do I have set up here? I get one of these panels. Okay, with the jack. Here's a little solar panel, and so I can power my charger. Plug that in, you know, put it in. Power my batteries by the sun, wherever that came out of. Okay.
How many volts?
Okay, how many? You have to read all of that. You have, because. How can I do it? Here we go. It's a wrong device. So this is a 12 volt jack. This is actually designed to give your battery a trickle charge. You can buy these. Do not buy Harbor Freight ones. God, they are junk. The red with the red coating. They say they're real. It's true they're cheap, but they just don't last.
All the solar panels from there are junk.
That red one for your car for the trickle charge. That is absolutely junk. I mean,
what do you mean by triple charge? What does that mean?
Trickle charge.
Oh, trickle.
Your car is sitting for a while. Let's say you and with your fleet, some of your other cars that you're not driving. you put this on the dashboard and you plug this into your cigarette lighter, so it's keeping the battery charged. Okay, so a lot of the devices for the RV trade or for automobiles you can use in emergencies for your in your home. When I don't have the little Mickey Mouse things here, but your cell phone, if you have a car jack, you plug it into here and you can charge your cell phone. It seems like in Altadena I've always had blackouts when my cell phone was down, but I could sit outside during the daytime and talk by charging the phone directly with this. So these little devices are great, and you could link them together, you know, however it goes. I have three or four. You could link them together. I forgot. One increases, how does it work? One increases voltage, you know, depending if you link them one way or the other.
Parallel or series?
Parallel or series, depending what you're trying to power.
More volts.
This device, also designed for your cigarette lighter, is just a little simple inverter. Okay, so if you have there's direct current DC, and there's alternating current, which is your household current. So if you have a regular appliance that you want to power, in theory, I could power it into a panel, depending on what I'm trying to power. You need to read the specs on the back. I could plug it in here, set this in the sun, and power a small device off of this just by plugging it in, one plug only. If I had a big panel, I could put a power strip on here and power a few devices. I have a huge 5,400 watt, I guess, inverter for a solar system at home, and I could attach panels to it and just plug into that in an emergency. And actually, the essence of a solar system is charging batteries. Anyway, I guess you all know that, because if you're not charging batteries, you have no power at night.
I was going to ask if you use it directly from the sun to your...
In an emergency, you can do that, but if you're not charging batteries, that's what you're working off of at night. All good solar systems, you're charging batteries. Now, I say good, in my opinion, because all these guys that the DWP, they're giving these rebates, I don't know if they still are, solarize your home, more than half the cost is labor. So all these big rebates are just paying for the labor part, which is okay, because if you don't know how to do it, you're going to hire someone to do it. Real Goods does it. Like the average home might be $10,000 to $20,000, depending on what you want to do. But the rebate people for DWP, they'll tell you don't need batteries. You don't want batteries. What do you want batteries for? There aren't that many blackouts that often. I mean, that's what they'll tell you. In fact, they won't do it, most of them. So what they want to do is, they're guys that were installing the screen doors and the garage doors last year, for the most part, and now they're into this while the rebates last, and they're going to be into something else. So they're doing that because that's what the DWP is telling them to do. Because what you're doing, let's say if you do that program, even though you get rebates, you're actually a power producer for the grid. Nothing wrong with that. If you produce more than you use, you get a credit. I don't think they're actually giving checks yet, even though they said you're going to get a credit, not a check. You're not really making anything. But that's a good thing. But you're a producer for the grid. But when the grid goes down, you have no power. In fact, they do something called anti-islanding, I think, so that you will go down when the grid goes down, because they don't want somebody coming to your house and you have power and nobody else does.
Then you can still use your power during the day, though, right? When the sun is on your solar panel, you just won't.
It depends how you wired everything. If you don't, I think you can, but I think probably if you had somebody else do it and you're a power producer for DWP, you probably can't. Mm. Because you're just going into the grid. You're going in one way and coming out like everybody else. So if you know what your system is and you've wired it, maybe you can use your power during the light. I'm only telling you that because if you like Ted, who walked by, he taught himself everything. He said, I never had electrical training. You can read the NEC code book. You can figure out how a lot of this stuff works, and you just do it step by step by step. Okay, you'll just learn how the system works. This is not what I'm intending for today anyway. Because we could spend a whole day and I could be non-repetitive and it would be all about how the panels work, how the batteries work, how the inverters work. I'd have Gary do half the talking.
That's right.
I mean, because that's his thing. But, you know, it's an electrical training on how, and there's many, many ways to do it. That's why when you get real goods, the catalog, they tell you how to size your system, how to build your system. And the average Joe says, I just want a solar system. I don't want to think about all this stuff. Well, that's why you spend a lot of money for something that you don't need or it's overpriced. You do need to think through your usage and you are building a system for your own home. So, and this is just electrical knick-knack stuff that I'm talking about today. This little device or something like this. A little simple solar charger. You put your batteries in the back, one unit piece. So if you can charge your batteries by the sun, there's another little box. You just put your batteries in there.
Make sure your batteries are the type that are rechargeable.
Yeah. Of course. What is the current best rechargeable batteries? NiCads are kind of passe, aren't they?
If you use NiCads, they have a tendency to develop a memory. Yeah. People are familiar with that.
That's the early NiCads. Isn't there a new generation of NiCad?
Nickel metal hydride. Yeah, nickel metal hydride is better.
Nickel metal hydride? Yeah. Where would you buy that?
Amazon.
Anywhere?
Anywhere now. Most things that are coming out are nickel metal hydride because they know that NiCads are...
So that's your average... it's not an alkaline then, is it?
No. Alkaline will blow up in some of these.
The hobby store.
But nickel, say it again?
Nickel metal hydride.
You would get that not at CVS though, would you?
Yeah.
You would?
How about 99 cent store? Maybe.
Walmart. Now that are... The companies that are producing batteries, they still... are producing nickel metal hydride because that's what's coming out.
Little devices like this are nice because you can power them, or there's a little solar panel, or you can power it. Same with this device. This has a radio and a flashlight. Pull out that thing in that box. And I'm not ready for it. This one has a little spot where you can crank it here, and you have a radio, and somewhere there's a little jack where you can plug in to charge your cell phone or smaller devices. Okay, so it's a great little device. I forgot where I got it exactly.
You said it was a gift last time.
Maybe. If that's what I said, that must be true. I'm going to wake up when I left the county facility. Hold up that plastic thing right there, Jim. Forgot about that. Yeah. If you guys don't have one of those, you should definitely get one. If the water heater goes out, you can hang that in the backyard and take a hot shower.
Okay. Yeah, these are great.
I have three or four of them. If you have a family, you'd want a bunch of them. Of course, if you have a yard, in an emergency, your gas heater goes out, you can just heat water in a big pot and wash yourself that way. I mean, people did used to do that. Like in the old westerns, they just heated water, and then you sat in the tub, and you washed yourself, and then you rinsed off. Do you guys have any questions about any of this? Then everything is perfectly clear.
Wow. Well, I'll say one thing. I bought a radio, a crankable radio. It lasted about 2 years.
What happened?
The crank finally broke. Because there's cheap plastic gears in there.
Okay, this is the Free Play from Bates & Company. That. I had a knockoff, and at a certain point, you're cranking it, and you hear the spring unwind. So that's the end of the crank function.
So it's
if it has a solar panel, it'll still work.
Mine didn't.
Okay, so then that has some, you can't use it anymore.
Yeah.
That's the end of that radio.
Wow.
But there is a lot of products, like Dune has told me, not everything lasts forever.
Throw it over tree branch, place it up to whatever level I want.
But keep it, you always have it.
That's true.
What I recommend, just like what we were talking about with food and water, whatever everybody's needs in their household is different. You know, what for various reasons, the age of the household, medical needs. Find what you know, what's going to go down if the power goes out, and find alternatives to that in your household. And you don't have to go out and spend thousands of dollars, just do it little by little by little. Now, you guys all know Ed Begley, right? He spent, he has 100 panels on his roof. He lives in a small little place in Studio City. He has like, I think 102 panels on his roof. He said it cost him $85,000 when he did it over 10 years ago. And he doesn't have any of these knickknacks. It's a fully modern household with everything you could imagine. And he doesn't use all the power that he produces. He showed me his batteries in his garage. Each of them is about half the size of this picnic bench. I think there's like 8 or so. Powers his car, you know, powers the whole house. But the batteries the panels on the roof charge the batteries, and you work off the batteries. That's the way you want to do it. And he's become an expert on checking the specific gravity of the batteries and all that, just making sure they're okay.
He's got the lead acid batteries. They will last for 20 years if properly taken care of.
Is that right?
Those lead acid batteries are tremendous.
Yeah.
If properly taken care of, they'll last longer.
Yeah, well, they won't last forever, but you know,
yeah.
He said that it took him... It took about 10 years for the system to pay for itself, That is to say, what he would have paid in electrical bills, you start subtracting that, it took about 10 years. Yeah.
My friend Nick got his system 1 year ago. He lives in Diamond Bar, $21,000. He pays zero electric bill, but Edison was very specific about how much panels he could put on his roof. He was restricted. He can only get 20% more than what he normally uses.
He could only put that much more potential on his roof.
Yeah.
He's
connected to them. He's not off the grid.
There's a problem.
What'd you say?
There's the problem. Right.
Yeah, there's the problem.
I wouldn't do that.
There's restrictions on that. I didn't realize it, but he was telling me. But
so,
he's happy.
You can also do, I don't know what the legality is, right? When I tell you things and there's a legal issue, that's your problem. I mean, you know, I don't know what the legality is.
Right.
But I know that you could instead build a standalone system.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You build panels.
You put the
batteries, and you run lines to wherever you want to use that power off of those batteries.
But you cannot sell it. You can only have it for personal use.
If it's a standalone system, how would you be selling it?
Right.
My youngest daughter lives out in the desert, and she's totally off the grid. The house was never hooked up, ever. It was always off the grid. So she can put up as many panels as she wants.
Oh, okay. That's different. That sounds like freedom to me.
Yeah, it is, really.
I just had to say that.
Any other questions about any of these things? I know we've touched over a lot of categories, but I'm going to start packing things up, and then we could go on a walk and try some of the wild foods anyway. Okay?
Good job. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Maybe you could pass some of the...